Hello everyone, welcome back to another episode of the Travelxp podcast. Jamie Lowe here, talking to you from Bristol, and I am very happy to be joined by Sandy today. Sandy is all the way, I say all the way, she's the closest guest that I've spoken to on this podcast so far, all the way in London. Sandy, how are you doing today?
I'm doing great. It's a beautiful sunny day in London, which we've had hundreds of in the last few weeks, of course, as you couldn't go out. But no, yeah, I feel great. I'm excited to do this. I love talking about, you know, vlogging and travel. It's my favorite topic in the world, basically.
So. Mine too, Sandy. So just before the podcast started, I mentioned that I was from Bristol and you were like, oh, if I could leave London, I would go to Bristol. What is it about Bristol that you like?
Actually worked with I think Visit Bristol at some point a few years ago, and they sent me over there to do a vlog of the city, and I was like, oh yeah, I'll leave London, you know, like I'm a very snobby Londoner. And I arrived there and I thought, this is so cool. Like, it was just when vegan food started to happen. Obviously it's huge in Bristol now, right? Yeah. And like the food markets, and what's that trendy area called with the graffiti?
Oh, the St Nick's Market.
Yeah, I don't know, maybe it's so long ago, but I just thought it was kind of like a little combined Shoreditch by the seaside. I don't know, I loved it. I thought it was really cool.
Yeah, Bristol is beautiful. For those that don't know, tuning into the podcast, I'm from Bristol in the southwest of the United Kingdom, and it's an old port city, so it's filled with this beautiful canal. It's got a harbour in it, and we are not too far from the seaside, like Sandy says. But Sandy, we've strangely heard more about me than you so far in this podcast, but this chat is all about you, of course, so why don't you introduce yourselves to the audience and to myself.
I'm Sandy. My YouTube channel is called Sandy Makes Sense. Whether or not I do make sense, we can decide that after the podcast. I'm a German girl in London. This is kind of my tagline. So I came over here 11 years ago, well, just after school, and I was an au pair, as so many German girls do. If there's anyone out there German, you'll be like, yep, I did the same. To just work as a nanny, and I fell in love with England and London, and I've never left since. My parents thought I was going to go for 6 months, and then I went for 11 years. And eventually I started my YouTube channel just mainly talking about life as a German in London and how strange British people are and stuff like that, and like cool habits, and then eventually extended it beyond London to do travel as well.
So it sort of started organically then. You sort of started talking about your experience living in a different country. And then when that sort of, you know, that sort of, not dried up necessarily in content, but organically grew further, you started exploring elsewhere.
Pretty much. I never thought this could turn into a job when it first came out. It was almost 10 years ago now. I don't know how long you've sort of been on the YouTube world, but people like Community Channel, or I Justine, or Mystery Guitar Man, like really old school people were big then. And I was like, oh, that's cool. I can film myself. So yeah, it was just to share some fun stories, basically with my friends at home, about how British people never whip their creams and stuff like that. It was very odd.
I whipped some cream yesterday. What sort of cream are we talking about?
Maybe that's a 10 years ago type of, but like these, you know, these things, and I, you know, kind of went somewhere from there very slowly.
Right, so Sandy, we are obviously still in lockdown here in the UK. It's beginning to ease slowly. Things are starting to loosen up. But in London, I'm guessing it's been quite difficult because you've gone from being such a bustling city. And I spent a lot of time in London last summer, and summer in London is just magical, isn't it? And the past few sort of hints of summer that we've had in the good weather have obviously been very different to what it was. So how has been lockdown for you?
Where do I start? No, I'll kind of try and sort of combine it. When it first happened, London stopped, and I remember the night when Boris said you cannot meet friends. Yeah, I remember that. And then I also live by the tube, as everybody does in London, so the tube wasn't running, and it just died. And it was like that for a very long time. And I, you know, I mean, we'll maybe talk about this more. It's very slowly adjusted. Took me many weeks. I was very sad in the beginning for various reasons that we don't need to go into. But yeah, eventually I just kind of found out my own little routine, and, you know, own local corner shops that sell eggs, and local coffee shops that were still doing takeaway coffee, and the beauty of walking around your area and finding things that you never knew were there. But it took me quite some time, and I'm sure a lot of other Londoners felt the same, because we're just used to being out, not in.
So What things have you discovered? You mentioned that you've found some hidden gems in your local area that you didn't notice before.
I think that's probably the main thing. Because I live in East London, I don't know, for those guys of you that know it, it's called Mile End. It's a one stop away from Liverpool Street. And it's not known like Shoreditch or, you know, Notting Hill. It's just a kind of a residential area. So every time I would think about going somewhere, I would think about taking the tube to Central or further west or north or south, whatever. And now I was obviously forced to explore on my own. On foot. So there's a park which has a pond with swans and fish, and it's so beautiful that I looked at it thinking, what is this? Is this London? And there's a road called Roman Road again, which has like a very trendy sort of vibe coming up now, which I didn't know was there, you know, where they sell these things that go like viral in London, like colorful croissants, whatever. And I discovered that. And then for myself, if you know, I mean, everyone talks about what are you going to take away from lockdown, and a lot of people say lots of rubbish, and a lot of people say, you know, like, oh yeah, my life has changed for the better. I don't think it's going to be that much of a difference, but if I can try to take one thing away, it's just like exploring local always is worth it. And you know, Mile End is not as boring as I thought, basically.
Lockdown in London must be weird, but like you say, things are starting to get a bit more back to normal now. We're allowed to get out and about and enjoy the parks and the local area. So have you seen sort of, you know, the parks spilling with people having picnics, which of course they're allowed to do now, and sunbathing and that sort of thing?
The closest park to where I live is Victoria Park. I think it's probably the second largest park in London. It's pretty big. It has lots of festivals and things like that. But the people that live around here must be sensible is the right word. So when I go running there in the last 2 weeks since we've been allowed out-ish, yeah, it's still kind of the same. It doesn't feel that busy. You didn't expect, you know, you didn't see those, like you said, bigger groups of people picnicking. You'd see one couple and like 50 to 100 meters further, another one, but that was really it. But then yesterday I took the bike to meet my friend for the very first time in 9 weeks and do like a distant workout in her local park, which is Rockwell Park. Again, it doesn't matter, but it's very far away from where I am. It took me a very long time to cycle there, but it was good exercise. And that was a completely different picture. People around there are, I guess, not sensible, if you wanted. And they did exactly what you just said, to the moment where I almost felt a little bit on edge just because I hadn't seen it in so many weeks. But I think, yeah, it depends on, I guess, what people are used to in their local area. She says it's been like that for the whole of lockdown.
Yeah, it has been a little bit. I mean, by the seaside here, Weston-super-Mare is about 5 miles from where I am now, which is a beautiful beach. It's huge, long, golden sands. And this time of year is absolutely gorgeous because it's so big that you can go and chill on the beach. But we did see a lot of people on the promenade, which is the walkway just in front of the seafront, a lot of people there. And I did just sort of think, ooh, that's, I don't know, I'm still not really comfortable with that. But, you know, we've got to get used to a new normal. We've got to get out of this house sometime. So hopefully with the right advice, we can do it safely. But Sandy, let's get back to the beginning, because you sort of mentioned before that you came to England as an au pair and started documenting your journey. But where did that turn into you becoming sort of this professional traveller?
Oh, I don't know. I did London content for so many years, more than half of my whole YouTube career. And I really like it. But eventually I was like, I want to travel and I want to take my camera. And I started to watch travel vlogs from other people. And I got inspired and I thought maybe I can try this. So I did a few very early semi-successful attempts. But then I had an idea, and which is all about involving the audience with a lot of sort of semi-professional YouTubers will tell you work. So I did a where should I travel, you vote type thing, right? So viewers voted where I should go. And then I went there and I did a little mini series from it. And that really kicked off. And then 6 months later, I got my first paid travel gig and I was like, I've made it. I'm living my dream. So yeah, a lot of hard work. I mean, it's still been, you know, like I said, 6 to 9 months of me just paying for everything and, you know, going everywhere, everything myself. And eventually slowly it happened, but I still, I think if you say professional traveler, it's a very different story. If I watch my videos from a few years ago now, my
but
first
that's
travel
the same blog. With anyone though. When I look back at my old stuff, I think, ooh. But at the moment, that was the best. That was me. That was who I was at that moment in time. So I don't think we can be necessarily like.
No, I think you're right. I loved, like, I have one specific video in mind which I loved at the time. It's when we went to the north to Galicia, which is an area in northern Spain known for the best wine in the world, if you ask me. And I made a vlog which has actually been quite successful, but also one of the comments with the most thumbs up is, you're not actually showing the area, you're just showing your face. And it's true, you know, I was very much like a vlogger like this, and like a few b-rolls, signs of some random buildings, and that's it. The video still did well, but nowadays it kind of, you know, I know that
nobody knows how to be a visual storyteller right out the box. You had to learn by doing, and you know, that's where you are now today. But people will notice on your YouTube channel that you have quite a unique username, Sandy Makes Sense. That's sort of your moniker, your sort of online persona. You mentioned a little bit about it earlier, but who is Sandy Makes Sense? Where did that come from?
So, you know, when you have an idea and you think it's a good idea, right? And you feel creatively inspired, and that idea comes back around and around, and that was creating my YouTube channel, right? I knew what I wanted to do, I knew what I, like, my first video wanted to look like, but I didn't have an idea about a name. I actually have a very old YouTube channel, if any of you want to see some funny, like, private videos. It's called England Sandy, because that was, like, obviously what it was at the time. I was like, no, I need to start fresh, I need to have a cool name. And it really was just the alliteration moment, you know, because, like, people can remember it. And because it's like one of those 12, like, midnight kind of ideas where I was like, okay, I think people will remember it. I think it could be something like making sense of my life in England. But that's really where it ended. I just, you know, got up at, like I said, at midnight and reserved it on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook, and YouTube, and whatever there was at the time, because you want your handle to be correct, right? Mm-hmm. And went back to bed. It just kind of came to me, I guess.
You know, that's a good a reason as any. I mean, the thing about sort of branding yourself online is it, you know, it has to have a ring to it. It has to sort of say a little bit about who you are. So Sandy Makes Sense, it sort of speaks that you're a bit of a, you know, a vivacious character, you know, you're pretty happy-go-lucky. And it doesn't, like, those three words together don't necessarily, you know, spell out something, but they give a sense of something, don't they? And I think, you know, maybe it was a happy accident. But that's exactly one of the questions that a lot of Travelxp viewers ask me, is it's, you know, how do you get into it? How do you start creating travel content? And I think your advice would be similar to the one that I give out, is you just got to get on and do it. You just got to start creating things.
Exactly. I mean, my first ever travel vlog, yeah, was when I went to, I was a raver. You know, I was in Ibiza quite frequently raving to Carl Coxon in Space and things like that. Some people who are a bit older might know very well what that is still, although I don't know, maybe since when has it been closed?
I know, like, Carl Coxon.
You know? Okay, good. So that was my life, yeah? I was living for the raver scene and for Ibiza. So I was like, if I can bring the passion for one destination across, it will be raving in Ibiza. Obviously, that's a terrible idea, because most of the time when you're there, you don't feel great other than at night. So the vlog is terrible because I'm just tired and, like, hungover on the beach all the time. But I did it. You know, that's the thing. I remember being on the beach thinking, no, I just want to sleep, have a beer and sunset, and then we'll go out again. My friend said, you said you want to do a travel vlog. Now do it. Come on. Like, I was like, okay, I'll try. Let me film some waves. Okay, nice. Okay, I'll go back. You know, so, but I did it, and it never did very well, but I kind of, you know, did my first travel vlog.
But a lot of the things that I've been seeing in your YouTube videos are lots of different cuisines. So talk me through some of the things that you've done. What are the standout sort of world foods that you've had?
Oh, what a lovely question. Where do I start? So I have to talk about this one trip I did, because I think it was just the closest to my heart and the most well put together just idea behind the topic, and is actually in northern Italy. So one of the areas that's, you know, that was hit by the current crisis quite badly. So there's an area in northern Italy called Trentino.
I've been there. My tongue. I know. It's shaped in a butterfly, isn't it? The region.
Yeah. So it's like so beautiful. It's in the mountains. It's like actual real northern Italy. It's like just underneath. And sort of the higher you go, the more beautiful it gets. And I did a food-based trip for 6 days around the mountains. And it actually is also a very good example to go back to the story. Because initially when we started filming and eating, we just filmed and ate. And it was like, today we're eating this. Today, and I was like, oh, I don't know if that's going to be interesting for 6 days. I'm just eating mountain cheese. But actually, it turned out like the longer we stayed, the more I learned about the cuisine over there and what it's made out of. And yes, it's mountain cheese and a lot of meat. And it's not very friendly for people like me who really kind of are pescatarian sort of 80, 90% of the time. But when I'm on a trip like this, I wouldn't miss out. And it was all about the sort of sustainability and locally sourced factor, right? So I'm sure you've seen that coming through in a lot of sort of, you know, local cuisines. I know a lot of Eastern European countries now do sort of locally only and local produce, but over there it was just a different story. I mean, some of the, so we visited a dairy producer, sorry for too much detail, but who doesn't artificially impregnate the cows? Mm. So it was like so much detail. It was like, these are the bulls and these are the cows and this is the cheese. We don't make a lot, but we sell it to this restaurant. And we were there in this dairy farm and it was so local. Yeah, it doesn't get any more local and sort of raw than this. And that was the story. And that's also why I loved the food, because everywhere we ate, we knew exactly where the food came from. And that for me just kind of maybe shed a new light on Italian food as well, because people are like, oh, it's pizza and pasta. But this was, I call it mountain food, from like locally sourced mountain food with so much heart. So for me, that was like my most exciting culinary experience out of many of them.
I haven't eaten yet and my stomach's rumbling, so we're going to leave food there for now and get back to travel. So how do you think the lockdown is going to change the way that we all travel?
I mean, you know, this is the question, yeah? Everyone's talking about it. You hear everything from this is the end to in 2 months, everything is going to be back to normal, right? I personally am not one of those preaching people who's like, hopefully everyone will know about sustainable travel and blah, blah, blah. But I do hope that there's an element that comes, you know, that kind of comes with it, that just people will start thinking about less airplane travel if where less necessary, maybe explore more local, whatever that means for the people. So I hope that people will take this away. For me as a travel vlogger, that is going to be very difficult, but I can try and highlight. I'm sure you know this as well, like we have a certain responsibility to highlight areas such as Trentino above areas such as Amsterdam, because everybody goes to Amsterdam or Rome, right? So I hope that will stick with people in the long run. And if you like, I don't think it's going to change that much. I hope, you know, there's going to be a mask. People have to wear masks when they're on public transport and planes. If it comes to me, I'm happy to do that for the rest of my life. I don't mind. I do like the heightened hygiene. That can all stay. But, you know, I think further down the line, yeah, people should hopefully be a bit more considerate and cleaner. But I don't think that, like I said, it's the end, or equally that, you know, everything is going to be immediately back to normal tomorrow either.
Obviously, your travel plans have been tarnished, I suppose, for the rest of the year, and you have videos in the can waiting for, you know, you to add the magic to it and turn it into the stories that we know from you. But, you know, what are your plans going ahead for the, let's say, the next 6 months as a content creator?
So it seems, if everything goes well, that October is going to be the month that we can start potentially working as this sort of again. So I have a few plans around the first travel, I guess, content creation is going to be traveling to Italy. Italy have reopened the borders from the 1st of July, and my friend is getting married in Italy in September, last week of September. So I want to make a whole little, like, you know, getting married in Italy, not me, but my friend, and, you know, like, because it's going to be very, very beautiful. So that would be a little mini series, and maybe traveling to Italy for the first time after lockdown. What is it like? I don't actually think it's going to be that dramatic.
Fantastic. So we have been sort of working with a campaign that talks about our appreciation for travel. So it's called Thank You Travel. So I want to know some of the things that you are grateful to travel for.
When I was in Dominica, which is a tiny little island in the Caribbean, which you probably know, but some people might not know, and it's not the Dominican Republic, it's different. I was in Dominica earlier this year, just before everything happened, and we got a chance to do a whale watching trip. And I have never done that. It was my biggest dream. It was the number one on my bucket list, maybe number two after visiting Japan, but it was always there. And we got to do a whale watching trip, and I saw it, whales. And I was there with three of my best travel friends that I've made through this job. And we were all crying because we were all cancer, you know, the cancers tend to be very emotional. And we were crying our eyes out because there was whales, and we were in the sunshine in the Caribbean, and we were working at the same time. And I sat there thinking, I have amazing friends and I'm seeing whales. And I'm, you know, so I guess the connection that I have with, you know, new friends, new experiences, and, you know, just like having found like-minded people to share once in a lifetime experiences.
What an emotional story. I felt like I was there with you, but it is, I think it is seeing incredible animals like that sort of just, you know, it's something about animals that sort of make you present, make you sort of, you know, they glue your feet in the moment. I remember a similar experience that I had when I was out on a boat in Wales, and this pod of wild dolphins, about 20 of them, just came and just started showing off for us, and it was incredible. And I was like, ah, this is a moment that I'm going to remember for the rest of my life. Well, let's take a moment and see if your travel journey has taught you anything. So we are going to play a game now of true or false. So now there's no sort of judgment or pressure here, because my on the spot geography is terrible, and I'm sure a lot of people's is too. But this is, it's more of a travel general knowledge sort of list of questions. So the capital of Libya is Benghazi. Is it true or false?
False.
False. You are correct. It is Tripoli. I forgot to mention, these are true or false questions. Oh, second question is, Brazil is the only country in the Americas to have their official language as Portuguese.
Correct.
You're very good. You're very good. Okay, next question is, according to Scottish law, it is illegal to be in drunk and in charge of a cow.
Correct.
Yes, we have a lot of these weird bylaws in England. It says here that since 1972, it's been illegal in Scotland to be drunk and in charge of a cow. And if found guilty, you could be fined £200 and jailed for up to 51 weeks.
I did not know that, but I did. I went and worked with the Edinburgh Tourism Board a few years ago, and I heard it then. They told us it's like one of those fun facts that you put in your Insta story. You know, like,
keep away from those cows. I mean, I don't know, like, because people don't necessarily like ride on a cow, so it's not like dangerous driving of a cow. And I'm not too sure that cows are, you know, that responsive to human commands. So I'm not sure what is so dangerous about a drunk person ordering a cow about. But we'll move on to the next question. Five, the Great Wall of China is visible from space. True or false?
That is true.
It's false. Although the Great Wall spans some 4,500 miles, it's constructed from materials that make it difficult to discern from space. So I guess because it's not shiny, it's from like rough rock, isn't it? Okay, so the next question is, the currency of France is the franc. You should know this one.
No, that's wrong.
It's the euro.
Franks. I did go to France as a very young boy, and francs were still in circulation. So I did, and I was given a Deutsche Mark once. So the next question is, the unicorn is the national animal of Scotland.
No.
It's true.
Really?
Yeah.
I never heard that. I thought you were going to say Ireland because of, you know, people say Ireland has like some magical fairies and stuff. Okay, I didn't know that.
Apparently, unicorns are associated with purity, strength and power. Hence, they were chosen to be their national animal. So the next question is, Monaco is the smallest country in the world. True or false?
False, because it's the Vatican.
There you go. Sorry, broken my mic. I was so excited for you to get that answer right. But it was right. The Vatican City is the smallest country with only 0.44 square kilometres. I think you did pretty well there. That was pretty good.
I surprised myself.
I want to know in the comment section of wherever people are watching this podcast or listening to it, of course, did you manage to get that cow question? God, insane British bylaws. I'm sure every country has their own weird laws, but we have just about reached the end of today's podcast. Before we say goodbye completely, is there anything that you'd like to say to the viewers?
I think it's just don't lose hope, right? Like, I think it's okay to be sad and it's okay to be annoyed, and you know, there's millions of other people who feel just as bad as you, but I think we're getting through this, and I think we will travel again pretty soon, maybe even this year. So,
oh, what a lovely way to end the show. A message of hope. Sandy, it was such fun talking to you today. I'm sure all the viewers at home got to know you a lot more. If you want to find out more about what Sandy's been up to in her illustrious travel past and, of course, her travel future when that starts again, you can check out Sandy's YouTube channel. Don't forget to follow her on all her social media channels, and don't forget to check out all the other interviews from this series. But for now, this is Jamie Lowe in Bristol and Sandy Makes Sense in London signing off. Bye-bye.